thank you, Andrew, and thank you, Tom. Intensely moving to hear my life in those lights. Tom particularly has led the school through noons and nights in the last 5 years and has been an unwavering support to me personally, so thank you. Thank you, Matt and Jen and Billy, and thank you all. I'm so moved to see my life before me, really, in this beautiful 1930s lecture room this winter evening. It's like an academic career told in people row upon row. I've received such generous gifts of friendship and collegiality and common thinking over the years that gifts came first to mind when I thought about this lecture. In an hour, let us raise our toasts. But first, for winter. There are 12 very short parts to this lecture. And they approach midnight in different ways, offering different kinds of material. I won't have fathomed all the relationships between the pieces, but I hope they'll echo and circle each other. They're all bound by the logic of transition through darkness and returning light. We don't want to feel that we're at the end of Marlowe's Dr. Faustus, counting the inexorable minutes towards a midnight deadline. The stars move still, still times run, the clock will strike. That's not the mood I want to set. So I won't count us down. I'm just going to count us along gently. So, the first stroke of midnight. There's only one place to start. Donne seems to command it. There are real Donne scholars in the room. I will move in concentric circles out from Donne, letting him pose questions here. But Donne is the man to start our midnight with. I'll read just one stanza of his nocturnal, much as I'd like to read the whole. "'Tis the year's midnight, and it is the day's, Lucy's, who scarce 7 hours herself unmasks. The sun is spent, and now his flasks send forth light squibs, no constant rays. The world's whole sap is sunk. The general balm the hydroptic earth hath drunk, whither, as to the bed's feet, life is shrunk, dead and interred. Yet all these seem to laugh compared with me, who am their epitaph." The little word sap springs up with its green and sinks in the flat, slow stresses of that middle line, the fifth of nine. Each of the five stanzas enacts in its shape the pulling in to a midpoint and expansion, an hourglass shape, a timer turned. But midnight is not a turning point for this speaker, whose lover, being dead, will not return with the sun. Yet around each still point, the poem crackles with its life of thought and image. Those squibs may be the image of a spent sun, but still they are fireworks thrown into our path, sparking and popping in the night. Solstice comes from solstitium, the sun stopped stit, standing still. Seen from the northern hemisphere, the sun appears to stand at the Tropic of Capricorn, and that is midwinter. And then, day by day, it becomes clear that its course has turned, and back it comes. Donne holds us at the stopped and furthest point, 12, the last hour, which is also the zero hour, the beginning. At the hour of naught, Donne considers his own nothingness. If he were praying the hours, this would be matins, the night prayer made up from recited nocturnes. On a night of vigil, waiting and watching before a feast, the Feast of St. Lucy, an extended matins would lead at the dead of night into Lourdes, the prayer of the dawn hour. Those forms of prayer shape the poem, but here there's no preparation for dawn, only for the long night's festival. At the end of the poem, we're still in the deep midnight where we began, Let me call this hour her vigil and her eve, since this both the year's and the day's deep midnight is. Come back to that first stanza for a moment. Wither, ordinary word enough, catches in this company an echo of withering, the withering of grass, the sunken sap of the year, which might take us in any case to Psalm 89, those familiar words, years are like grass which groweth up. In the morning it flourisheth, in the evening it is cut down and withereth. Wonderfully, the perspective that shows us the whole world, that hydroptic earth, a bloated drinking globe, turns suddenly more intimately human and domestic. As to the bed's feet, life is shrunk. Now the notes on this in the big Donne editions tend to gloss the inversion of the physiological draining of life at the moment of death from the arms and legs first. Life shrinks to the heart, and Donne is inverting it. And I'm really glad to have that pointed out, and I'm absolutely sure that's what Donne meant. But I can't undo the association I've always made with the feeling of being not dead, but in bed, stuck, drained and constrained. It only takes a bout of flu to know how the horizon closes in. You see little further than the end of the bed. The books you've tried to read and thrown away, the crumbs, the hot water bottle, they're all down there and the rest of the world is out of reach. I can't have been alone during 2020, that year with so many winter seasons, in thinking and saying over and over, life is shrunk. Here we are at the bed's feet. I thought of it visiting an elderly, bed-bound friend recently, whose life is shrunk to the bed's feet. The end of the bed where a kind granddaughter has hung garlands, cheering, but not enough of a world to live in for 24 hours a day. Bed was in Donne's mind again when he gave a sermon on the morning after the solstice, the 14th of December 1617, urging listeners to get up, to seek Christ at this earliest moment of the returning light and regeneration. This was a different kind of solstice writing, for the first light of the new day, for a public crowd at court. Christ may be sought in the bed and missed, Donne said. Look carefully down there at the bed's feet. We have good meditations there in bed, and Christ may be nearer to us when we are asleep in our beds than when we are awake. But howsoever, the bed is not his ordinary station. That's the sermon of morning. But here in the poetry of night, we are, as it were, embedded. The poet himself is the epitaph of all these dead or near-dead things. And we read him his words, which are now imagined carved in cool stone on a gravestone epitaph, as well as quick and living. Epitaph and also emblem. Donne repeatedly announces himself as the emblem of whole concepts or states. Here in the nocturnal, he is the image of death. Study me then, he says, for I am every dead thing. Donne begins another winter midnight poem, a gift to the Countess of Bedford. With himself again as an emblem of the between times threshold hour. This twilight of 2 years, not past, not next, some emblem is of me, or I of this, who, meteor-like, of stuff and form perplexed, whose what and where in disputation is, if I should call me anything, should miss. No clear woodcut for the emblem books, then, but formless. Something as elusive as weather, meteor-like. All the works I'm going to touch on tonight make individuals at particular moments into emblems, sometimes archetypes, and just as interesting, I think, emblems into individuals. Two, When I first planned this event, it was for St. Lucy's Day, the 13th of December, the feast day for which Donne wrote this nocturnal. And I imagined a sort of borehole or ice strata plunged down through the centuries of people coming to that time, that midwinter day, with its associations bound together of darkness, the lowest ebb of the year, and a saint associated with light, Lucy, light, sight, and less commonly mentioned, the patron saint of authors. Writing at the solstitial still point, I thought, yes, that's my lecture. Words at the juncture of the sun's utmost retreat and return. But already, without any logistical rearrangements, the lecture was out of kilter, complex as calendrical matters tend to become, a necessary braiding of times and stories. 13th of December was the traditional, generally accepted date of the solstice in the 1610s, when Britain was using the Julian calendar. But after the reform of 1752, which was said to steal 11 days of people's lives, though really it was more of a recalibration, Lucy and the solstice drifted apart. Lucy kept her calendar date, the 13th, but not her time in the natural cycle. So her festival now came well in advance of the shortest day, around the 21st. If your event was dependent upon nature, if it was a market or an agricultural fair, you got to move with nature. But if you were a saint having your saint's day, you stayed with your date in the calendar. It's very confusing in the 1760s, and everyone was confused. So for any post-reform reader, that's two midnight phenomena already, and only the start of all the midnights we encounter in the winter season. The archetypal patterns of dark turning to light, decay to regeneration, come again themselves revived at Christmas itself, the arrival of the bright Christ in the darkness celebrated at midnight, the first moment of the new day. In the early centuries of Christianity, Christmas was the solstice, or close enough to be believed so. 25th of December had been understood as midwinter since at least the first century. It's the date Pliny gives, for example. The early church aligned the birth of Christ with the birth of the sun. These dates were already parting company, in fact. The shortest day was about the 21st of December in the 4th century. So just 3 centuries and they're drifting apart. Bede in 8th century Northumbria decides that midwinter, the 25th, is Christmas, also the start of the year. He has them all lined up. And the notion of Christmas as solstice, that felicitous aligning, gives rise to some of the most potently concise moments in all midwinter writing. Christopher Smart, in his Hymn for the Nativity, see the powers of darkness routed, taken at their utmost gloom. Or incomparably in the quietly ecstatic line of Jubilate Agno, for before the nativity is the dead of the winter, and after it the quick. Quick of winter. Let us take that with us. In terms of the sun seen from the earth, there is only one winter still point. But for human beings, with all their stories and religions and changing calendars, there are many midnights. The pattern of midnights goes on to Twelfth Night, to Epiphany, on through Epiphany Tide, which is still part of Catholic Christmas. We are still in Catholic Christmas. To the 2nd of February, Candlemas, the Feast of the Purification, again, a coming out from darkness into light. New Year, that's very mobile. Its mobility ranges beyond even Candlemas, since the church year begins with the conception of Christ, the beginning of the beginning, on Lady Day, the 25th of March. And that's still the start of our financial year. Our school, academic years stay there. They start in Michaelmas, the other strong candidate for the beginning. All these times of the year that vie for our attention as the start. And of course that makes sense agriculturally. The harvest is done, it's the midnight of full barns and bare ground in which to sow again. Land was customarily leased annually from Michaelmas to Michaelmas, so farmers would arrive on their new plot in the autumn. Thomas Tusser, in one of the most famous almanac books of the 16th century, his Points of Good Husbandry, which became an early modern classic, begins with September. Now enter John, old farmer is gone, and we have the new man looking round, you know, licking his pencil, assessing the situation. As for January, February, March, they lived in 2 years at once over there on that side of the year. Was it 1575 or 76 or a hyphenated 75-26? I thought it was just student historians like me struggling, getting lost in the early modern period, who would make mistakes. But then I realized that actually people were confused by it at the time. Edmund Spenser campaigned for an end to the confusion in the prologue to his Shepherd's Calendar, and a definite start in January. We maintain a custom of counting the seasons from the month of January, he says, for the incarnation of our mighty saviour, good reason, who, as then renewing the state of the decayed world and returning the compass of expired years to their former date and first commencement, left to us, his heirs, a memorial of his birth in the end of the last year and beginning of the next. Concisely stated. And also, in keeping with his pretense of writing like a shepherd, he said, it suited common understanding to start a calendar in January. The two new years remained, but centuries of classical and Christian culture did align with Spenser and have accustomed us to the trajectory of a year that begins in deep winter. There's not even a snowdrop, and it's far too early to prune or plough. The passage from old to new is not so definite as the striking of a clock. Donne's analogy between the time of the year and the time of the day is in many ways a very simple one. We get it instantly. It was then, in a residual way, as it still is, part of the standard scheme of correspondences. But the scheme prompts many questions and comes in many forms. How is the transition between years like the transition between days? And once we're setting circles within circles, the stages of human life are going to become involved, especially since the midwinter transition is customarily a time for personal audit. Where am I in my life? What's past? What's to come? The New Year moment is too an intimation of mortality, what with the withered world insisting that all things die and the entry of a new time prompting the question, how many left? The correspondence between seasons and stages of life was established in classical thought and accepted in early modern England as the way the world worked. God's intricately correlated creation. Some diagrams. This is from the 11th century encyclopedia compiled by Beatforth and showing the wheel of the year. The winter solstice, as you see, is neatly at the juncture of December and January. It's the juncture also of winter and spring, so already we're on intriguing territory, since midwinter is not obviously the start of spring. But here it is, the first moment of spring and childhood, which works very well with the birth of a Christ child. We would need a month of midnights to fathom all the wheels and cycles of medieval and early modern thought. But I just wanted to indicate the range of wheels and the power of their imagery. The stages of life wheel in the 14th century Delisle Psalter in the middle is particularly vivid and famous, grippingly discussed by Mary Dove in her book, The Perfect Ages of a Man's Life, which I deeply recommend. end. The perfect age is the one at the top here, the reigning king of ages, fully mature and not yet falling apart. It's an excellent notion of middle age, I think, though apparently it doesn't quite apply to women. We won't go with that one. That's in the high summer position, opposite the winter region, where we find the figures saying, I begin to fail, I am dust and ashes. God in the centre, of course, all ages. The furthest image, a later example, not in a lavish manuscript here, but a book passed from hand to hand, the Calendar of Shepherd's Almanac, first printed in France in the 1490s, but appearing again and again with really baffling popularity through the 16th century. This one just shows the year and its zodiac signs, the months represented by the occupations of the months, the customary tasks. And January here is the man at the table at about 7 o'clock. A clock. Of course, the comparison with clock cycles is asking to be made and was made as clocks came increasingly into use. So let's just have in our minds the glorious Hampton Court clock ticking through hours and years, and being not just an instrument, but a map of the universe, with all its shapes correlating. It's a map of creation, Earth at the centre, this is pre-Copernican, the calendar of months and tasks, Tom, all the tasks around the edge and days on the moving dial, and midnight would be at the top on this 24-hour dial. So when you look at old Joe outside, we can see it as a map of the harmonious universe. And there too is the lovely brass dial of a domestic clock from Donne's own time. Midnight at the top, both nadir and noon. All these circles countering the linear passage of time, which ticks away and does not come back. All these circles suggesting the year's essentially comic structure, the tragic fall and then up again. Donne, in the Nocturnal, dissociates himself from the comic dial. Nor shall my sun renew. But elsewhere, he participates in the great tradition of New Year poetry, which making himself a Janus, young and old, formed and formless, looking out on past and future, one among so many writers to do so. I'm going to look at some New Year poems and suggest that the twilight of 2 years, nor past, not next, must count as one of the most creative times of all. Ovid begins his fasti, not with a muse, but with the god Janus, source of the silent gliding year. The whole year, and thus Ovid's poetic account of the year's culture, flows from Janus. If he's the springing source of time's river, he is also the gatekeeper, the janitor. He's the doorman, a staff in his right hand and a key in his left. He unlocks the temples and the future itself. Now here's a classical Janus, and here, I'm afraid gratuitously, is the January from the Winchester Psalter, because I just love the combination of a key in one hand and the ringing of the doorbell. Janus and Ovid have a conversation. The poet listens with his hair on end to this extraordinary god before him, who says that he was born of chaos. He emerged from the primal mass of undifferentiated air, water, earth, and fire. No wonder Ovid wanted to meet him and take notes. Ovid says, I who have been a round mass, Janus says, I who had been a round mass and a bulk without form, resorted to a shape and limbs appropriate to a god. Even now, small indication of my once chaotic shape, what's in front and behind in me appears the same. I want to draw a comparison back to Donne at this twilight time, who on the verge of the new year describes himself as of stuff and form perplexed, whose what and where in disputation is a chaos. Whether or not Donne had in mind the history of Jane as born from chaos, the concepts of formlessness and creation are conceptually joined. Jane emerges from chaos, carrying the past in him and with his 360-degree watch on time. And he's our guide, showing the way into the year. Ovid has him say, "The right to turn its hinge is entirely mine." How amazing. The world turns because of this man and his hinge. Vertendi cardinis, to turn the hinge. Ovid asks all sorts of sensible questions of the tutor god, and it is a tutorial. He's got his notebook. Why does the new year start in the cold? It would be so much better starting in spring. And being Ovid, he then goes into a great verdant description of spring because he just can't stop himself, and then he comes back. Or spring in a subclause. Says Janus, the sun begins in winter, and so must the year. So again, the solstice. New Year gift-giving was long established by this time in Rome. The gifts were called strenae, omens of good luck. But why honey and dates, asks Ovid. And Janus says, so that the flavour may follow what ensues, and the year continue sweet. Somehow the luck sticks. It sticks with you, with your sticky honey. In medieval and early modern Christian England too, New Year was a time of gifts, now part of the 12-day Christmas festival. The New Year's gift appeared personified in Ben Jonson's 1616 entertainment, Christmas His Mask. There's Christmas himself on stage, and he brings his 10 children, who are called things like Carol and Mince Pie and Wassail. And there's New Year's gift standing there in a smart suit of livery with orange and rosemary on his head, a collar of gingerbread, torchbearer carrying marchpane, nice marzipan sculpture, plenty of wine. Nothing too melancholy or indeed philosophical about the gift as represented here. But of course, there were many other kinds of New Year gift. The round object I've got here, glad to find this. This is a wooden trencher, a flat plate like a cheese board, and decorated sets of these made really good presents and could be used at New Year feasts. They might have epigrams painted on them, a bit like fortune cookie quotes today. There were gifts of money, gifts to help with your moral improvement, gifts to educate, help you with your resolutions, gifts of love and luck, charms to the traveller setting out into the new time, go well. Gifts exchanged among communities, like the earthenware bottles that the Birmingham historian Sophie Cope shows to have been presents among loyalists in the 1650s, supporting and cheering each other under Republican rule. Drink this, make a posset, we'll survive. Some gifts were not drink or coins, but poems, seasonal gifts of art. If you were a poet, this was work time. You must ask for your money and you must give your art to earn it. Verses to your patron were definitely expected. Verses to friends and lovers were better than honey to give. So writers use their art at this pivotal moment, weighing elegy and hope. Queen Elizabeth received more New Year writing than she might care to read. Over in France, Jean Passerat, among many other poets, sent his patron a poem every New Year through the 1570s and 80s. But in 1582, his poem about nothing, De Nihilo, became suddenly a phenomenon, and a whole sequence of adaptations ensued across Europe, playing and posturing, turning and turning the paradoxical language of nothing. Strenae revised and continued each other, and so it went on, repetitively and changefully, and all modernists in the room will be thinking of how it goes right through to 1940 and Auden writing his New Year letter, which I promise will be the subject of this lecture volume 2. Part of what so interests me about these New Year poems is that because they were part of a festive tradition. There were things you were meant to say, aphorisms, generalized hopes, old time-worn themes, and these had a place in tightly wrought poems which were also explosions of new thinking. Poets deal with this differently, of course, and at its most intriguing, it's like finding parts of an almanac woodcut sitting in the middle of a Caravaggio or a Picasso. Donne writes this very situation into his poem for his friend Henry Goodyear at New Year. He's there doling out advice to the recipient, to pray, to fear God, let falsehood like a discord... let falsehood like a discord anger you, else not be froward. But why do I touch things of which none is in your practice new, and fables or fruit trenchers teach as much? Ah, those trenchers I knew would come in handy. And dealing in mottos like a fruit plate, Donne says. Is my poem no more than that? Well, it's much more, of course. The well-worn seasonal wisdom comes wrapped within Donne's larger scheme, and they talk to each other. In another New Year poem, and just to show you the range of what he does, Donne offers to the Countess of Bedford a lesson of herself being the epitome, the emblem for others to learn from. I would show future times what you were and teach them to urge towards such. The verse is for a moment imagined as a kind of winter preserving. But no, the verse will vanish. The poet is almost nothing. At the midpoint of the poem, of course it's a midpoint, he shrinks in a sort of lavish self-diminishment to one corn of one low anthill's dust and less. He turns on the hinge and he cedes to God as Lucy's guide, the preserver of her future. Robert Herrick conducts a different kind of ceremony in his New Year poems. Writing to his old friend and patron Simeon Stuart in the New Year of 1623, he performs a burning off of the past. The first section of his poem is all occupatio. He will not write of navies destroyed and political plotting and the sickness of the kingdom, the news and noise of difficult times. No, he'll tell of festivity instead, of food and games and of crackling laurel, which foresounds a plenteous harvest to your grounds. All there in 12 little words. The growing and dying and growing again, the laurel gestures to the original branches given as strenae in the ancient world. But here it's nicely domestic and homely, a bit of practical economy. Gardeners still dig in ashes to help the soil. And then, says Herrick, then as ye sit about your embers, call not to mind these fled Decembers, but think on these that are to appear as daughters of the instant year. Well, the fled Decembers are called to mind, of course, even as Herrick dispatches them. They're laid on the Christmas fire, and at the join between the two couplets, the poem turns its Janus head. To sit about one's embers. The still point is contained there, held within the conviviality of the poem. Herrick makes it safe, that moment. He does the very opposite of Donne, who holds us in the vastness of the dark. Herrick's already on to daughters and rosebuds. His art protects us from the dark. That's what he needs it to do. For John Williams, the displaced bishop who had survived 3 years in the Tower, Herrick lit another kind of fire, perfumed and spiced like the January fires in Rome. Williams and the poet are to sing a carol together in praise of the great Lord, who is both Christ and the returned clergyman, which is extraordinary, but again contained within the simple festive beauty of the opening. Fly hence, pale care, no more remember past sorrows with the fled December, but let each pleasant cheek appear smooth as the childhood of the year, and sing a carol here. However theologically complex the poem becomes, we see all through it the image of children singing and their smooth cheeks. Here's the year's childhood singing out through the year's midnight. And the word pleasant here, so bland and unperplexed a word, has a power of its own, I think, more than pleasantries. Nam Tate in the 1690s wrote annual New Year odes as poet laureate. National pride was the almost unvarying subject. British heroes had gone forth and conquered, heralding the new golden age. What then should happy Britain do, blessed with the gifts and giver too? That sort of thing. A century later, more of the same from Henry James Pye as laureate, specialising in New Year bombast. Rather than reject the tradition altogether, though, as they might well have done, writers offered other kinds of vision at the turn. Here's one, William Cowper, one of the great 18th century writers of nature. He revised the gift-giving tradition in 1792 by describing a surprise he had received. He addressed his poem to the giver, to the nightingale, which the author heard sing on New Year's Day. He questioned the meaning of a sound heard out of season. Whence is it that amazed I hear from yonder withered spray, the foremost morn of all the year, the melody of May? Was it a portent of happier days at hand? Cowper received the augury and let it lift him. He could take into the year the knowledge at least of a bird that has the power to make every season spring. Quiet, delicate, questioning, brief, unsure of its own significance, the poem was in every way a contrast to the odes of imperial triumph. It was different too from the solstitial poems of Christian revelation. As Cowper well knew, the appearance of spring in midwinter was the vital essence of a Christian's new year. But he could not feel himself blessed. He was cast out, he believed, from hearing God's voice. He stood at a painful distance from the joy of the nativity as it had been expressed by new year poets before him, like Richard Crashaw welcoming summer in winter, day in night. At a sidelong angle to the season, casting himself as a wanderer out alone, Cowper carefully saved up the hope of the nightingale's song. Cowper's lasting contribution to the literature of winter gifts, however, was in The Task, the long poem of 1785, which is devoted for half of its length to the times of a winter day, the winter evening, the winter morning, and a winter walk at noon. There is no quest for wildness or sublimity in Cowper's winter writing. His unquiet mind made life quite alarming as it enough already. He writes about ways of finding small delights and kind protection. By the time dusk fell at 4 or 5 on a winter evening, Cowper could feel that outward duties were done and the firelight room could be a haven. Now stir the fire, close the shutters fast, let fall the curtains, wheel the sofa round. That wheeling round picks up the wheeling of the year. The year's clock hand answered here by a brass caster running over a wooden floor or the rug. It is the indoor rhyme to the outdoor occupations Cowper felt so right in their rhythm. All healthful are the employees of rural life, reiterated as the wheel of time runs round, still standing and beginning still. Cowper makes shapes like this. It's his way of wrestling down the disorder he perceived in the world. He makes shapes in the firelit room, where there is work and conversation and a woman sits embroidering like this. Here the needle plies its busy task. The pattern grows. The well-depicted flower wrought patiently into the snowy lawn unfolds its bosom, buds and leaves and sprigs and curling tendrils. It's as if Cowper's stretching a thread from the winter solstice across the circle, the wheel of time, to midsummer. It's a very old image. Think of the summer flowers elaborately embroidered on the Green Knight's saddle in the 14th century, and on Bertilac's coat, a summer woven into silk as the proper vestment of the evergreen priest of winter. Here in Cooper's parlour, the embroidered flower blooms not magically, but stitch by stitch in anticipation and memory of a summer garden. Cooper can't resist the too neat pun on lawn. There it is, holding in the tight circle of fabric the idea of a snowy lawn in the dark garden outside and the green lawn of spring. "Composure is thy gift," he writes of winter evenings. A great gift for a mind given to frightening turbulence. Composure of self, composure of family or small company gathered in the evening after the day's disparate tasks. Composure of art. The year's midnight is Cooper's interval of steady safety. Let me set among the clocks and wheels of this evening an image by the photographer Gary Fabian Miller. It's called "There Is No Shadow." It's made of time and light and crucially of darkness. Fabian Miller is a photographer in that his medium is light, but he doesn't use a camera. He controls the fall of light onto a sensitive paper called cyberchrome, passing the beam through colored glass or liquid, or through the translucent material of leaves. There must be no accidental light at all in his darkroom, total black. So he's learned to work in the dark by touch and rhythm. The exposures which produce these intense colors from the light sensitive paper are very long, the opposite of the snapshot instant, an hour at least, 10, 15, 20 hours being more normal. All this in the service of light. "I am enthralled by the light," he says. "My single purpose is to be aware of it." He means it. His life on Dartmoor for 30 years has been organized around observing sunlight, as he does on daily walks at sunrise and sunset. "There is no shadow." Is this a work of midsummer noon when we shield our eyes from light? Or Donne's midwinter nothing casting no shadow? It is a still point picture, I think, in being centripetal and centrifugal at once, pulling our attention in and yet appearing to radiate out. It hung in an exhibition called Midwinter Blaze in a Scottish December. And so too did the sequence of images I'm about to show you, which are all called Midwinter Blaze. "Winter suits him," he says. "He walks at night and into the dawn. He walks at dusk and into the dark." After 30 years of doing it, he can still be astonished by the pink of a winter sunset. Repeating like this, he becomes a living archive of times and seasons. What we see in these images seems at once to be very large on a planetary scale and very intimate, bodily, delicate, and the two are held together. He is a moon. He is an eye. Is there some strange floater moving across this eye? And now a clear, very delicate looking surface suggesting the back of an eye registering light. Alice Oswald, who has often worked with Miller, wrote words in response to or continuation of these pictures. "Notice this," she begins. "The moon at midnight, not quite full, filming the window's shadow on my wall, lands it latticed like a crane fly's close-up wings exactly where this picture hangs." There's that multiplicity of scales again. The moon, the tiny delicate wings of a crane fly, and those shapes of light thrown through the windows onto walls remind me of Gawain at midwinter, watching day by day the light move across his room at Bertilac's castle, a kind of sundial as he counts the midwinter days. I feel too that I'm seeing an eclipse, but I don't know in this eclipse which is the shadow and which is the shadowed thing. Of the six friends whose lives converge and scatter and converge again in Virginia Woolf's 1931 novel, The Waves, only Bernard is left in the last section, an old man going back over their stories, a writer with a notebook, working out what kind of form or meaning they have made, if they have made any meaning at all. He thinks of the moments in which these friends have come together, in their maturity, their third age, for instance. After harvest, they met at Hampton Court, making their own circle to answer the clock circle, though the image they use is that of a flower, a six-sided flower. The structure is now visible, Rhoda has felt. How swift life runs from January to December is what Bernard thinks, struggling to make a space in that rapidly running life to stop and form that moment. The Waves was from the first a book of seasons. Starting out, Woolf typed the title and under it the part she proposed, spring, summer, autumn, winter. Soon afterwards, she made a new outline in which the book was structured by the stages of childhood, youth, maturity. The book she imagined correlated the four seasons to the ages of man. Both cycles would be held within the course of a day. She began with the dawn, light gradually coming into the room. Ah, light thrown onto the walls and onto the table. Circles within circles, scales of time tucked within each other, questioning and interpreting each other. She makes across her novel the arc rather than the circle. We get the arc of the sun, which is what Dante gives us, arc rather than circle. She wanted to write, she said, the life of anybody. She would write the inner life of her composite anybody in a way that could hardly be more different from the schematically humoured everyman figures of the old almanacs. But her idiosyncratic, psychologically distinct people are united in the anonymous scheme of the times, the elements, the ages, these impersonal structures of the world. Bernard, at the close, is an elderly figure of winter. He reports a moment when the rhythm stops for him. Leaning on a gate one day, he finds the rhymes and the humming all gone, the nonsense and the poetry. It's a moment of self-loss, which might elsewhere be ecstatic, but is here a sort of death. He's no longer the novelist making phrases, the Bernard he knows, the self he has lived with, that's come with him and sat by the fire, the self he's kept making up all these years. That self makes no answer. Set apart from life, with no stake in it, no appetite, he sees a faded world. The scene withered. It was like the eclipse when the sun went out and left the earth, flourishing in full summer foliage, withered, brittle, false. This is how Woolf writes Winter into a novel that takes place on a summer day. She had watched an eclipse at midsummer and kept rewriting the vision of the world emptied out. The heaviness of my despondency thrust open the gate I leant on. This is Bernard. See the passiveness of that. It pushed me, an elderly man, a heavy man with grey hair, through the colourless field, the empty field, no more to hear echoes, no more to see phantoms, to conjure up no opposition, but to walk always unshadowed, making no impress upon the dead earth. This is the still point, and it is both a death and a reaching beyond the individual. But Woolf doesn't want to end there. Bernard, still old, not magically reborn, returns from the empty field. How then does light return to the world after the eclipse of the sun? Miraculously, not a word Woolf often uses, frailly, in thin stripes. Bernard goes to the restaurant where he will tell the story of his life. As he hangs up his coat, he taps some other person, an accidental visitor, a passerby, us, the reader. He taps them on the shoulder, and I said, sit with me. Oh, it's a still moment here. I don't need it, actually. I can totally, I'm just going to plow on through the midnight. Bernard anyway, is rescued from his still point. He uses his art. He goes off to catch a train. The 11th hour. It's the solstice when Sophia, in Ali Smith's novel Winter, the second in her seasonal quartet. In Winter, Sophia starts seeing a strange green dot that gets larger. Is it something in her eye, an abrasion, degeneration, detachment, floater, which at this point is still fairly small? The optician can't see anything wrong with her sight. The green dot becomes a beguiling presence in her field of view. The size of a head. A green head. Sophia is perfectly comfortable with this head, glad to talk to it, in fact, more benign towards this strange being than towards most other people. Its movement at near 4 o'clock in the winter dark on the shortest day is joyful to her. It's childlike, this green dot, enlarging to a head, a smudged, dusty child streaked with green, a summer child in the winter light. It bobs along behind her, bobbing like a helium balloon bought at a country fair, a green answer to the red balloon that bobs so companionably and animatedly behind the schoolboy Pascal in the film Le Ballon Rouge, which Smith loves. Sophia gets it out of the house, her balloon, into the garden and closes the door. But there it is again, quietly persistent in its comic buoyancy, tap-tapping, wanting to come in. What winter guest is this? Certainly one of the strange visitors in Smith's fiction who insist on coming in. If it's a figment of the imagination, it doesn't make it any less real a thing to be tended and talked to. It is partly a visitor coming across the winter centuries from Gawain and the Green Knight. This green presence even has a sprig of holly in its mouth, like the holly bob carried by the knight, who rides into Arthur's court on New Year's Eve and leaves with his head tucked under his arm. In the Gawain poem, the visitation, the game of head for head testing, is received peculiarly as a gift. That's one of many strange things about the poem. Arthur receives the gift of marvels, the Hansel of Aventurus, in the first moments of the new year. He accepts the Green Knight as a new year education, like the books of instruction. And certainly, he accepts it as a work of art, an extravagant play of imagination, uniting the real and the fantastic at the hinge point. Smith, too, takes the gift and lets it enter with all the Green Knight's wildness and artful civility into the festive hall of her novel. Her associative freedom is part of her vivacious answer to the darkness of a winter world, a contemporary landscape of exclusion, lies, and suffering, the injustices of 2017, ordinary, everyday terribleness. The greenhead bobs and alters Sophia's sight. A child, an old man, a green man with spouting nostrils, lively when it turns into a stone, something like a sculpture by Barbara Hepworth. A Hepworth stone head, is it? Or the stone Hepworth carved away to make a window, to let the light through. This screen print is on the back page of Ali Smith's novel, emphasizing the piece which is taken out as the presence. What do these share, the Hepworth-like stone, the Green Knight-like head? They come in from the outside, bringing their own wild forces through the door. They are young, and they are old, and they last. Charles Lamb gave readers of the London magazine the gift of an old poem for the new year, 1821. His essay, New Year's Eve, mourned the loss of the departing year. He could not pivot on a couplet like Herrick to greet the coming time. It was the past he loved, the familiar hours of his own days, old friends, fled Decembers. I am naturally beforehand shy of novelties. And he could see little pleasure in travelling on into another year, which must bring him closer to the end. This lamb is in tribute to several lamb scholars in this room. In proportion as the years both lessen and shorten, he says, I set more count upon their periods and would fain lay my ineffectual finger upon the spoke of the great wheel. I am not content to pass away like a weaver's shuttle. Those metaphors solace me not, nor sweeten the unpalatable draught of mortality. I care not to be carried with the tide that smoothly bears human life to eternity, and reluct at the inevitable course of destiny. I am in love with this green earth. I would set up my tabernacle here. Lamb wasn't one to see the new year as the promised land. Others could go on ahead. But he rallied himself and his reader by writing out the whole of a new year poem by the 17th century poet and fisherman Charles Cotton. It was a gift poem from another age, and it heartened Lamb in the present. Plague on it, the last was ill enough. This cannot but make better proof. Or at the worst, as we brushed through the last, why so, we made this too. Conversational, unillusioned, surviving without miracles, as we can see now in the beautiful new two-volume edition of Cotton's very large work. Cotton's verses, Lamb thought, washed away morbid fear in a convivial January purge. Lamb passed them on to his readers and raised a toast. Made with Cotton's company, it becomes a toast both to the coming year and to the old voices, the art we might choose to take with us and make new. Thank you.